So how did the jukebox come to be?
I think it's sort of quite extraordinary that we're here recording this album here in this glorious Yehudi Menuhin School hall, really with a project that started with very, very humble beginnings.
In my living room in Philadelphia.
On a sort of jet-lagged whim. This was last year, actually, the first lockdown, wasn't it? March.
March 16th, I remember it very clearly.
And I'd just flown over to New York because we realised that we're married. We realised that we weren't going to see each other for months if we weren't on the same side of the pond at that point. So I got on this sort of last flight to New York before Trump closed the borders. And then, yeah, in a kind of jet-lagged state the next day, with all our concerts cancelled.
What are we going to do? So you suggested that we should put out one music video a day, and then you had the idea to make it request-based. So we sent out a little question on our social media channels, what do you want to hear? How can we entertain you? And, you know, we got very standard requests, Bach, Messiaen, and then we let it be known that Tom could arrange things that were not necessarily for violin and piano. And then it got very strange. Baby Shark, of course, Come on Eileen.
Britney Spears. We were kind of immediately in this very eclectic and very sort of unexpected mix. And I think that's what came to characterize the jukebox more than anything. And actually, in a serious way, became a real, something we felt really passionate about, actually. Juxtaposing and putting side by side music that might not normally be heard alongside other pieces, but actually trying to treat it all with as much love and care as we could.
Yeah, equalizing music, really. But no, nothing is greater or, less silly.
Yeah,
some things are silly. But everything deserves equal care, basically.
Yeah.
And one really cool kind of side effect of this is, you know, people who requested Led Zeppelin, say, stuck around and
Elgar.
Exactly, yeah, and vice versa. People who were perhaps a bit more conservative in their tastes were, I think they allowed themselves to smile at some of the sillier musical selections and costumes.
Costumes.
Let's not forget.
Elena's really in charge of costumes.
I was the wardrobe consultant.
Giant wardrobe at her parents' home in Maryland, which is where we were locked down. And actually, one of the other things we found in this very small community in Maryland was there were a number of auxiliary instruments. So suddenly we weren't just restricted to violin and piano. Actually, we ordered a kazoo because I've always loved playing the kazoo. But then various neighbours had a couple of recorders, a cello. Elena ended up playing.
Concertina.
Yeah, mandolin.
My dad's triangle.
That's right.
So, yeah. So, a whole range.
So it suddenly became a kind of, two-person band, I suppose. And that led to all sorts more fun.
Exactly. Yes, we learned how to use a multi-tracking app. Very, very elementary. No fancy software here, but we started having fun playing with many versions of ourselves, which that tradition has made its way onto this album. That it turned out to be a lot of fun.
And one of the other traditions of the jukebox, which I think has somehow spontaneously worked its way in, is we realised the night before our final recording session that we didn't really have the right opening track for the album. In our typical style, I ended up staying up quite late last night arranging a new song for us for four violins, which Elena multi-tracked and piano, a very beautiful song of Jerome Kern, which I just loved and which had the right sort of optimistic message, look for the silver lining, which seemed a lovely way to open and also a kind of immediate opening of the door in this sort of nostalgic vein. I think, jukebox is a kind of old-time method of listening to music, isn't it? This idea that you put in your coin and you pick your favourite song.
Yes.
Actually, I mean, the other thing we should say is that this album owes so much to all sorts of people, and in fact there were selections on here that were definitely chosen by the public that we would never have thought to include, so
yes.
It's very much a collaborative effort.
One unexpected twist of the jukebox project was that a few weeks on, a dear friend and champion of classical music, Victoria Roby, contacted us and said, or wondered, whether we might use the platform as a vehicle for some new composer commissions that would premiere on the Jukebox, but then of course be accessible to all players. So with her help and support, we amazingly got the opportunity to commission six of our very favorite people and musicians to write us pieces.
And they were given just a couple of weeks, really.
Yes. Now,
and it was a very, very quick turnaround. And these are normally composers who'd be booked up years ahead, but, you know, pandemics being what they are and things having been cancelled, suddenly people had more space in their diaries. And actually, the other funny thing was that simultaneously with Victoria contacting us, Mark Simpson said, "Oh, I've been writing you a piece and just wondered if you might want to play it." And suddenly it was amazing how everything just fitted into place. So that was Mark's amazing, incredibly exciting piece, was the first of the commissions. And
yes.
Six wonderfully contrasting and brilliant pieces.
Mark kicked things off, and then we have works by Clarice Assad, Cheryl Francis Hoad, Hugh Watkins, Donald Grant, and Jesse Montgomery. So a huge range of styles and ambiances, but we love all of them so much.
And I think all six pieces very much reflect how people were feeling during that first lockdown. Mm-hmm. You know, they were very much in response to the times, so it feels a very sort of relevant album to the times it's been created through, you know, dreamed up like literally the first day of the first lockdown and recorded in this, whatever it is now, the third lockdown?
Millionth lockdown. Coming together to make this album, this Jukebox album, has been quite poignant, actually. I mean, we had lots of rather absurd memories from that first period in the pandemic. But there were points of real sadness and sort of bewilderment trying to find our way. And it's been quite special, actually, revisiting all of these different pieces, thinking about those specific days that we recorded those works, now here in this beautiful space. But it's in a way been a privilege to kind of look back and process all of the highs and lows of the pandemic, I would say.
But I think it's both looking back and looking forward. I hope it has a sort of energy and optimism, this disc, which, you know, will propel us to these times we're all dreaming of, when we can all get back and make music together, so we don't just have to have five of ourselves, you know, on the stage together. Lovely as that is.